lasting relationships. My church will be a safe haven for all who come. So what does it mean to form authentic, loving relationships? In light of Scripture. Speak the truth in love, okay? What else? What's an authentic, loving relationship in light of the gospel? Okay. All right. Okay. Okay. What else? Okay. So practically, how does this look? If I want to form relationships with people, how does this work? Counselor.
Oh, no.
You have to talk to people. But that, now in an engineering town, that's tough, right? I'm going to tell you, when we started St. Andrews, that was agony. Agony. Like, I was the only person who could talk in this church. It was awful. Like, until we got Trung and Jonathan in this church grew painfully slow because it was up to Kelly and me. We were the only two who could carry on a conversation when visitors came in. And then Trung and Jonathan came into the church, and they could carry on conversations, and Grace and Kimberly, and the church exploded. Because now we had people who could carry on conversations. So St. Andrews only grows because parishioners now are warm and friendly and inviting, like I think you all figured that out, and they can carry on conversations. It cannot be me, and it cannot be Kelly and Chris and Scott. It has to be y'all. But your relationships and the way this thing works only is as good as you all investing in relationships. So we've got people who come on Sunday and leave and never partake in anything. They don't go out to lunch with anybody. They never have anyone over to their home. They never show up at a men's night or a women's night or a Bible study or anything. And it's been years later, and I'll ask members about them, and they're like, who? Right? That's not an authentic forming relationship. If you want to be part of a family, you need to be part of it. But it does mean this, and this is the hardest part, I think, of authentic relationships, is getting through this phase. So, how's the weather? Right? The awkward, I can't think of anything to talk about phase. But you got to bust through that phase, right? We all get to that phase where I can't think of what to talk through, but that's like you've gone through the initial, and then you got to work through that phase, but that's where the friendship starts. You got to bust through that phase and be comfortable with silence and then get through that phase, okay? Sometimes having three couples there helps, but just kind of work through that. But be at things. Be the presence, ministry. But the other thing that helps is I will support members, other members of my church family in any way I can, spiritually, emotionally, and through acts of service, right? So to do that requires you being open and you being there, right? So who are the most powerfully influential people in your lives? That were not your parents. Who are people outside of your family unit that are powerfully influential in your lives? Why are they? Can you think of any? Why does that help? How about y'all? Okay. What are you gonna say? Why? You see him all the time. So presence, investing time, presence, openness, right? So the ministry of presence matters. You got to be there. You got to be open. You got to be vulnerable. Do you risk in vulnerability? So if I want to build relationship with a new person coming in and they're a weaker Christian, I've got to be open enough and vulnerable and secure in myself to be able to share with them, right? I got to risk that. Right, I try to do that from the pulpit where I can and it's appropriate, and then with people, you'll see me. I'm pretty open about where I've been and what I've been through, and hopefully that helps you all to be open, right? Kelly is as well, as much as we can, but we try to model that so you all are that way with others. But authentic relationships, because we don't think that being inauthentic is helpful. So some pastors, and I was at seminary, Mike and I heard this, where guys are like, you have the right to expect from me to model Jesus and perfection and whatever. That's hogwash. I don't think you have the right to see me model Jesus and perfection. You're going to see me model an imperfect Christian following. I'm just preaching the gospel to you. I'm going to love you as best I can and do the best I can, but you're going to see me warts and all. Because if you see me as a perfect Christian, you're going to see a lie, okay? I'm just not that person. I tell my congregation regularly, one day God will bring you a good pastor. I just keep praying for that, right? So he hasn't done it yet. You guys are just not worthy. I will worship God regularly as a part of this community through the sacrament of Holy Communion. In confirmation, and this is a prayer, and this is something that sometimes our congregation struggles with, and this is just part of growing up as a Christian. Regularly, what does regularly mean? Confirmation says I will bring my kids regularly, right? I will be here regularly. What does that mean? Yeah, what does regularly mean? It's a very difficult concept for people in our culture lately. Like, I never miss church. When my parents went to another church or getting a divorce, I was a teenager, and as soon as I could drive, I asked them if I could go back to my Anglican church because they were divorced and trying. I never missed church. Like, if I was sick and missed church, I was upset. Like, now I've got people who show up once every 3 months, and they feel like that's regularly, and I should give them a gold star. Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Like, what's going on, man? It's like, I should be here ready to praise the Lord and worshiping and all that stuff, and it should be attitude. But now, lately in our culture, we're just like, dude, you know, I was tired, and, you know. I have a 10 o'clock service, and people were griping, well, we need an 11 o'clock service. It's too early. Or I got a 10 o'clock service, and now we need a 9 o'clock service because it's too late. And then we move to 9 o'clock service, and they're griping, well, we need an 11 o'clock. Well, now we've got the 11 o'clock service. Well, that one's too contemporary. We need to move the other one to that one. Well, you were just the ones who said we wanted a 9 o'clock service, and you wanted the traditional service at 9. Well, yeah, we said that, but now it's too, right? Yes. That's right. That's right. How about just go to church? But regularly, we're supposed to be, like, one of my seminary, Barclay, taught me this. Dr. Barclay, and I'm forever grateful for this attitude. His attitude all week, and he taught me this refrain, Sunday's coming, Sunday's coming, Sunday's coming. Is that part of your refrain? Are you looking forward to worshiping the Lord? Or not? So regularly, as often as you can do it, everyone misses from time to time. That's okay. We're not marking you down. We don't keep attendance here. But just, are you participating? Are you excited about church? Yeah, there's days we all don't feel like it. That's the liturgy, man. So, like, sometimes I don't feel like going through the liturgy, but that's the glory of the liturgy. I just do it. And then there's days, eventually it becomes part of you. So in the liturgy, what I found is I started it, I got bored with it, and then it became part of me. And now I just love it. So I will not gossip and will not allow others to bring gossip to me. I will speak the truth in love. This part is hard. Right? Pieces of gossip are like choice morsels. They sink into a man's innermost soul. I will not gossip, and I will not allow people to bring gossip to me. I will speak the truth in love. Now, it's two parts. I will not gossip, and I will speak the truth in love. So I don't sugarcoat it. I don't be brutal to people. But if I'm having trouble with someone, I will do that. I'll speak the truth in love. So don't gossip, don't slander. Now that's something that really gets people in trouble. I'll speak the truth in love. So we come for communion, and we have a time where we pass the peace. That's the one thing missing in our service right now because of COVID. Why do we pass the peace? Anybody know? So we pass the peace to say we're at peace with one another, but it's also a time there if you are not at peace. So fencing the table is you who are in love and charity with your neighbor and intend to lead a new life with God, right? Come in at that point, like I give this statement, you can come to the Lord's table. It's called fencing the table. And what we're reminding you at that point, if you're not in love and charity with your neighbor, you cannot come and receive communion. So it's our altar call. If you're not intending to lead a new life with God, do not come. So what we ask you to do is cross your arms in this fashion, and I'll say a prayer for you, okay? So that's the time to go out and reconcile with your brother or sister in Christ. So we want you to reconcile before you come before communion. It is a sin to take communion unreconciled. It is a bad sin, not a minor sin. It is a bad sin, okay? Don't do that. So you'll see the clergy do this. I do this. Everyone does this. It is also not acceptable when you're ticked off at the priest. I have this happen from time to time, and I will, because I was shocked at the first couple times, I will not give you communion if you do this. Forgive me when you're coming up for communion. That is not reconciling with the priest, okay? I will not give you communion if you do that. You need to sit down and reconcile with me before. So in the communion line, saying forgive me so you can get your communion is not reconciling, okay? So reconcile before you come up here. Now, clergy, I have the power, like if I know that you two are in a fight and you haven't reconciled and I see that, I can come and I will tell you, do not take communion and then come up. Or if I see that you're in some... Now, excommunication is different. So if you're in notorious sin and you have it, like I can ban you from the table or block you from the table, just say come up and I'll pray for you. And if you try to come up, I won't give you communion. Excommunication is different. Excommunication is always done for one sin. There's only one sin excommunication is ever done for. Does anybody know what that sin is? Yeah, or rebellion. Yeah, unrepentance or rebellion. So it's done for a notorious sin. That would be the start of it, right? So it's not done for just a sin that nobody knows about. I would block you from the table for that. But it would be a sin that's notorious, right? So you start doing drugs in the middle of the congregation, waving it around, and everybody sees it, right? Or you decide to openly do a Ouija board and everybody needs to see it. Or somebody has an affair and brings in the, I'm going to cheat on my spouse and bring my whatever ex right here. Everyone's going to see it. And then you've refused to repent. At that point, I bring a vestry member, a couple people, we've gone through the process, and then I would excommunicate. Then you're treated worse than an unbeliever. But then I have 3 weeks to write a letter to the bishop, and the bishop backs that excommunication. So we've disciplined people at the church here. There's a couple members that have been disciplined, handed over. I haven't formally had to excommunicate them because they've left, they've departed. But the bishop did hand them over to Satan. And one was for a business thing. She decided that I needed to be under her in business and openly rebuke the clergy and whatever and wouldn't serve under us unless we were under her business. She was in a pyramid scheme and refused to participate in the church unless we were under her business scheme, which we're not allowed to be under. And I wouldn't be under anyway. And so it was just a wicked thing. And so the bishop said, no, you're not allowed to anyway, but she wouldn't come under the authority of the church, and it was just devious. It was materialism anyway. And then we've had another one at the very beginning, and that woman was actually open into witchcraft, a couple other things. So it happens, and we will discipline if we have to, but anyway, those are the things. So community is the main thing, and those are the things, and we believe in communion. We believe in fellowship, and those are kind of the things that we do. So anyway. So I will not gossip. I will be in Bible study. I will be in communion. I will not allow others to bring gossip to me. I will speak the truth in love. I will not come up for communion when I am in unforgiveness. I will, when possible, be involved in a small group or Bible study. And so here what we're asking is just be involved. I mean, it's not a requirement, but just be involved in our small groups. Be involved outside the church. That's what we're saying. We've got family groups going on. We've got other activities to be involved outside to get to know people. So we have picnics. We have women's Bible studies. We have men's groups where they get together. We have fellowship groups where they get together. We have Bible studies. Just be involved in something. Get to know other members, and that's what we're saying. I will support and follow the leadership of the bishop, the rector, the vestry, and other church leaders. Then I commit to grow so that my faith is a personal relationship with God. I will strive to know God better and to love him even more. So let's look at that. So somebody get Galatians 5, 22 to 25. If somebody can get that passage, who can get that? Anybody? Raise your hand. Yeah, okay. Matthew 28, 19. Okay. Ephesians 4, 11 to 13. Somebody can get that one. Philippians 3, 7 through 11. Somebody can get that one. Anybody? Somebody got that? And then Colossians 1, 9 to 10. Okay. Let's read Galatians
5:22 to 25. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another. Sorry, I went too far.
Matthew 28:19. Ephesians 4, 11 to 13.
And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the full, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ.
Philippians 3, 7 through 11.
But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead.
And then Colossians 1, 9 and 10. So here it's, I'll strive to become more Christ-like through the study of and obedience of God's word. I commit myself to the spiritual disciplines of prayer, evangelism, fellowship, worship, and Holy Communion. So these are the aspects of a Christian, we believe. So I commit myself to spiritual disciplines. So basically reading and studying God's word, right? The disciplines of prayer, evangelism, fellowship, worship, and Holy Communion. So these are the disciplines of being a Christian. These are areas that you need to grow in, right? And these are the areas that we seek to help you develop in, but also these are the areas that you seek to grow in. So a lot of people sign this covenant, and are you serious about growing in these areas, right? Did you have a question? Oh, sorry. Spiritual disciplines are, do you fast? Do you pray? Do you think about these things? Do you evangelism? Do you fellowship with other believers? A lot of believers believe, man, I can go home on Sunday. I can just come here and go home. I don't have to be with other people. Am I worshiping the Lord? And then am I regularly partaking in communion? And I think COVID has been very interesting to me, because there's a certain subset of our of the parish, and a lot of them are just new to the faith, I think, or maybe they were in various churches, and we haven't seen them at all during this crisis. They haven't come for communion. And it just struck me that for some people, they just haven't really realized yet the importance of communion. Like, we're supposed to be taking it. It is a critical component of the faith, and they've come from traditions where maybe it wasn't. Some of them have come from traditions where it was important. But it's a necessary component of our faith. Like, so I'm an evangelical. I've always been Anglican, but I'm an evangelical as an Anglican, and it always surprises my Anglo-Catholic brethren. Well, maybe you don't take communion seriously. Well, of course I do. We have it all the time. Now, some Anglicans would like it once a month, and some Anglicans would like it once a quarter, and some Anglicans would like it every Sunday, but all Anglicans like it, and all of us should. I mean, it's a critical component to our faith, but why is it? And we need this component to our faith, and so that's one of the things we need. But we also need Bible reading, we need studying the Word, and we need prayer. And those things need to be developed as daily disciplines. So we would encourage you, if you haven't been reading your Bible, just pick it up maybe 5 minutes a day, or maybe 5 or 10 minutes every other day if it's brand new to you. Just start reading a reading plan. Skip the boring parts. If you find something boring, just go to another part that's interesting, okay? There's plenty of really cool parts, but just read. And then pray. 5 minutes a day if you're not used to praying, okay? Just start. Just start doing that. And then I might even journal my prayers down. I might even write my prayers out if that's maybe a better discipline. And then kind of keep, maybe have a prayer journal that you write. And then just kind of flip through that prayer journal every so often. I think you'll be shocked at the end of 6 months and when you go through that journal how many prayers God has answered. I was stunned. I kept a journal for a year when I was a youth minister. And I kept actually 2 years of journals. And I was like just flipping through one day because I never go back through and look. I just kind of move on and things. And I was stunned that God had answered prayers on every single page for 2 years. Here's the part I was stunned at. I'd forgotten all the prayers that I had prayed, and God had answered them all. And then I realized how ridiculous I was that I had forgotten all these prayers. Right? On all those days when you're like, God, you never hear me. And then he had answered all these prayers. Even like some stupid things, like the color of the car that I wanted. Anyway, God had answered all these prayers, and I had forgotten, because that's how we are, right? So it's just a really cool discipline I would encourage you to do. And don't beat yourself up on this stuff, but we have all kinds of interesting ways to do this. But fellowship with other believers, really important. Don't forget that. Prayer, evangelism, fellowship, and then studying and obeying God's word. Let's commit to serve. So if somebody can get Matthew 28:18-20, okay? Somebody else get 1 Corinthians 15:58, okay? Somebody get 1 Peter 3:15. 1 Peter 3:15, all right? Somebody get 1 Peter 4:9-11. 1 Peter 4, all right? All right, I will be an active participant in the ministry, vision, and purpose of St. Andrew's Church.
And Jesus came and said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age.
1 Corinthians 15:58. Peter 3:15.
But in your hearts, honor Christ as the Lord. Christ the Lord is holy. Always be prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for the reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect.
1 Peter 4:9-11.
Show hospitality to one another without grumbling. As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's various varied grace. Whoever speaks as one who speaks for oracles of God, whoever serves as one who serves by strength that God supplies, in order that in everything, God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. Glory and domain forever and ever.
So, I seek to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with others. So, that's one of the things that we do. Why are we named St. Andrews? We just read about that today. Does anybody wonder why were we named St. Andrews? What was significant about St. Andrew? There was the same name, Andrew. He was one of the apostles. What was interesting about the apostle Andrew, the disciple? Let's see. So passing alongside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, the brother of Simon, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. They immediately left their nets and followed him. And going on a little further, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother, who were in their boat mending their nets. And immediately they left. Right? So he was one of the first ones called. Right? That's what we learn in Mark. turn to Luke. Sorry. Turn to Luke. Luke. Oh my goodness. Am I thinking about John? Sorry, I'm looking at all the calls of the disciples. Okay, over here, sorry. Okay, here you go. Sorry, it's John. John chapter 1. And the next day, John was standing with two of his disciples, and he said, "Look in Jesus as he sat by, behold the Lamb of God." And the two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. And Jesus turned and saw them following and said to them, "What are you seeking?" And they said to him, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "here you are saying." And he said, "Come and you will see." And they came and saw where he was standing, and they stayed with him that day, for it was about the 10th hour. One of the two who heard John speak and followed Jesus was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. And he first found his own brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," means Christ. And he brought him to Jesus. And Jesus looked at him and said, "So you are Simon, the son of John. We shall be called Cephas," which means Peter. So the next day, So what's the first thing you noticed about Andrew in that one? What did Andrew do? He saw Christ, and then what does he do? He follows him. Then he shares it with Simon Peter. He's the first one to share the faith. Oh, John the Baptist is, but he's the first one to go share the faith. So he's the first missionary, we think. And so Andrew is the first missionary, fishers of men, right? So Andrew is a fisher of men, and he's kind of the first missionary. So St. Andrew's, when you name a church St. Andrew's, usually you're thinking of a missionary church, right? So that's one of the things that you do. And so that's one of the things we say. So we seek to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with others. And then I will use, and the name of the church was before I got here, so that's the group that started it. And then I will use the gifts that God has given me to bring glory to the church, to God, and serve my church family. So this is where we ask you all to think, what gifts do you have, and to pray, where will God use you? What gifts do you have? Where will God use you? And we have a lot of different ministry areas, right? So Brenda, what areas do we have for ministry in this church? So the Lord's table group up here. So this, everything here gets done by volunteers. So different teams we have for you to volunteer on. Like this, all the setup we do for communion, for instance, if you're a service person, nothing up there gets done without volunteers. This is the team that we have actually the hardest time finding people who want to help up here, but we can't do communion without that team. That team sets up everything up front. It sets up the candles. It sets up this. It takes care of the Lord's table, linens, ironing them, setting it up, taking care of the clergy robes, everything back there, everything that we do. We have the sound booth team. The sound booth team takes care of where Steve is, takes care of all this stuff, takes care of the cables, makes sure everything is set up, makes sure the overhead projectors are running, we're really trying to train new people because we have two services. We need a lot of people back there. We'll train you how to do that if you guys want to learn how to do anything back there. All we need for you is to be willing. Got to learn how to sound, got to learn how to do all that kind of stuff. So you come to music practice, Wayne will teach you how to do it, and learning how to run all of that. We run the visual through as long as Facebook and YouTube still let us do it, right? And do that live. Eventually, if I preach sermons like this today, they're going to cancel us. Anyway, but they do that, and then of course we have the music team. If you have any musical talent, you're welcome to do that. We have nursery downstairs. We have Sunday school classes in between. You have to be here at least 6 months before we allow you to do that, and you have to have a background check and all kinds of stuff to do that. We have hospitality group. The hospitality team goes out, and you can sign up for, like we just had a new baby born in the congregation, so if you want to sign up to bring food or bring food to sick or shut-ins and stuff like that, if you want to go visit shut-ins, we have a team that does that. We have Lincoln Village, so once a month we go help do construction or do service work at Lincoln Village, which is a ministry to kids who, if you've watched the movie Waiting for Superman, great movie to watch. It's a documentary on people. It's basically, it's a school that is started to help inner city kids who had no chance. And so this is a, what do you call the school? A charter school to help impoverished kids. And they set up a whole community around that to help their parents get jobs and to help their parents learn how to work. We rebuild houses so their parents get low-income housing, but it's actually good housing, and then kind of rebuild the whole community and then the kids and all the stuff. And those charter schools have been phenomenal getting those kids launched and successful in life. Anyway, that's a ministry we support. We give 2.5% of our budget over to missions. I'm trying to think what else we do. There's a couple, and then we run Bible studies, and we run a variety of other ministries. But also, if there's ministries you don't see us doing and you want to take part in or you want to start up, those things are available as well. Okay, so those are just some of the things we do. But if you have ministries, you have abilities, we have a vestry. The vestry is in charge of taking care of all kinds of things. If you want to serve on the vestry, you can talk to us too. We have a treasurer. We have all kinds of things that this church runs. All right. Final two, I commit to give. So I will support the ministry of St. Andrew's Church with the gifts that God gives me. Can somebody get Malachi 3:10? Now this one, I'm going to warn you, was kind of come up with early. We're going to tweak this one because it was come up with when we were AMIA Church, and I always mean to tweak this one. It's still in line with the ACNA. Malachi 3:10, Matthew, somebody get that one? Got that one? Okay. Matthew 6:19 to 21. Luke 11:42. 2 Corinthians 8:12 to 15. 2 Corinthians 8:12 to 15. 2 Corinthians 9:7 to 8. And 12 to 13. Somebody want to get that? Okay. All right. Go ahead. Malachi. Matthew 6:19 to 21.
Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also.
Okay. Luke 11:42.
But woe to you, Pharisees, for you tie mint and rue in every earth, and neglect justice and the love of God. These you ought to have done without neglecting the others.
2 Corinthians 8:12-15.
For if the readiness is there, it is acceptable according to what the person has, not according to what he does not have. For I don't mean that others should be eased and you burdened, but that as a matter of fairness, your abundance at the present time should supply their need, so that their abundance may supply your need, and there may be fairness. As it is written, whoever gathered much had nothing left over, and whoever gathered little had no lack.
All right, and 2 Corinthians 9:7-8 and 12-13.
Chapter 9,
verses 7 to 8 and verses 12 to 13.
Okay, By their approval of this service, they will glorify God because of your submission that comes from your confession of the gospel of Christ and the generosity of your contribution for them and for all others.
Okay. So I'm going to read three bullet points, and then we'll talk about this. So a little controversial, because if you hear me teach on it, I won't quite teach the giving tithe percentage. But it is in line with the ACNA standard. So I'll give you the official line of the ACNA, and then I'll give you the official Jeff line. So I understand that stewardship is not a matter of money, but a matter of trusting God in all things. I understand that stewardship consists of giving of my time, talents, and treasure. So that is one thing that we hold here, that stewardship should be giving of you. One of the things that I will teach here is that all that you have belongs to God. Now, what do you need for yourself? That's the standard in the New Testament. We live in a very different standard than the Old Testament, okay? Now, the ACNA standard in our canon, especially in the ADOTS canon, and Anglican Diocese of the South, and I've challenged the bishop on this because he's wrong. He's just wrong. And I've told him he's wrong. but he knows I've said it, is that the biblical standard of giving is the tithe or 10% of what God has given me. And I will joyfully grow towards giving that standard beyond as God leads me. There's no theologian that I'm aware of, and there's no church teaching that I know that says 10% is the standard that Moses gave. However, it is the suggested standard that the church gives. So I want you to understand that. It is a suggested standard that the church gives. The New Testament standard is this. So that's why we were going to change this little standard. The suggested standard that the church has always given is 10%, and it's always kind of been a standard to shoot for. God loves a cheerful giver is what the New Testament says, and the standard is this, and this is what people make a mistake in thinking when I say, oh, well, I don't have to give 10%, I can give 2%, I can give 1%. No, when you're thinking percentages, you're already thinking wrong, incorrectly. In the Bible, And Jesus says, everything I have, everything you have is his, right? That's how we're thinking. We're thinking for the advancement of the kingdom of God. And so it's a very different thinking. We're thinking for the advancement of the gospel and his service. And so when you come to Christ, all that you have is his. We're in a materialistic culture, so we try to think of, well, I need this, and I'm only going to give this to the Lord's kingdom. We're saying, no, you should be living a generous lifestyle. You should be living a lifestyle of service to God, right? Whether that's to the poor or to the church or to whatever. And so you should be praying on what the Lord's calling you to give and then giving that amount and living in a generous lifestyle and not living a materialistic lifestyle, okay? So the church has always said 10%. So we don't get into numbers of, well, I'm only giving 9.9%, so the Lord's not blessing me. Like, I was at seminary, I was giving my whole life to God, I was doing the best I could, and I was hardly making any money, and I literally had a family member tell me, you're not being blessed because you're not giving 10%. And this family member was doing none of that, nothing, getting a divorce at the time, doing all these other things, but he was given 10%, right? And so you get into this ridiculous, absurd thing. Do I give on gross? Do I give on tithe? Okay. So what we say is this, and I do give, or we try to give 10%, or sometimes we've given more, sometimes we've given less, whatever. And so we don't count that. We do ask our vestry members to at least give 5% and to work towards more. So you have to be giving to be a vestry member. It's ridiculous that you're deciding what to do with church money or participating or whatever. But we do say that you should be living a biblical standard and you should be praying through what you're giving. If you're not giving anything, I would say you're in sin. And if you're a bajillionaire and you're giving 1%, right? And you may be a bajillionaire and giving 10% would be wrong if the Lord's telling you to give more. You know what I mean? Like, that's why I'm saying percentages are not really where it's at. You just need to be praying. But I would say a good standard, and the church has always suggested that 10% is a good mark to look for. Does that make sense? But it's not a slave mark. Like, if you give 9.9, you're not going to hell. If you give 11, you're not getting bonus points. Does that make sense? And that's what I'm trying to free people of on that. People hear me preach against the tithe, and they're like, oh, great, 1%. Now I can go buy my car. You know, I can go buy the Maserati, or I've always wanted. I would say, like, are you helping the poor? Are you helping missions? Are you thinking about, are you thinking missionally? So any questions on that? I'm trying to put that out there for questions, thoughts. So we've got one of our bishops is like dead set that it's 10% and then you have to give more. Like if you read in our, right now we've got a catechism, which is 300 and some odd questions. And in the catechism, it says that the biblical minimum standard is 10%. Now it used to be even worse, which we all went after that and said, but the widow's mite, they use the widow's mite, but Jesus expects more. And they used the widow's mite. And the guys who came up with that catechism, that was just awful. So they at least took that out of there. There's several bishops who argue against it. So I've debated with our bishop on that particular standard. He holds to that. I was on the Constitution and Canons Committee. I was the chair. So we just fired off a document that challenged that and tried to have that removed. So our bishop personally is for that standard. I've argued with him against that. He loves me. I love him. He's wrong, whatever. But there's other bishops who are, I've debated with him scripturally on it. I just don't think he's got a leg to stand on there. But that's okay. He's still a bishop. And so I'm going to honor what he says. I'm not going to fight him on it. And if he tells me that we're going to officially teach it, then, you know, I'm not going to say it's biblical, though, I mean, because it's not. I don't think it is, but if he's going to say that we have to do it, then we do it. So I'm still a man under authority. So it's not like he's telling me, like, you know, say Methuselah is God or something. You know what I mean? So, you know, you understand. So we're still under authority, but I'm still not going to say it's right. But he's not like that's what he personally believes. And so we kind of debate on that. This statement here, I just didn't want you to be bound thinking that if I give 8.7%, I'm in this sin. But I also, does it make sense? I'm just trying to help. Any questions on that?
Anyway,
I say what I think, and I think what I say. I don't know. Can you correct me, Mike? Was I wrong on anything?
No.
He went to RTS with me, so. Yeah, I'm just trying to tell him. I was like, I have no idea. Whatever. So, I won't say it while I'm on mic. I commit to pray for St. Andrew's Church, its leaders, its ministry. Oh, by the way, giving. So St. Andrew's has grown in our giving. If everyone was giving close to 10%, though, I'll tell you this much, or even close, we would be able to bring on more ministry staff, youth ministers, stuff like that. So we do challenge folks to think about what you're giving, right? We have been on a shoestring budget most of the time here, but that slows us down for getting a building, for getting a building fund, for bringing on staff. We took a risk bringing Wayne on as our music leader. You know, all this stuff costs money. So in order to expand, you know, members have to give, and those things matter. So we do say, please consider what you're giving. We also give 2.5% to Anglican Frontier Missions. We've got two seminary students that are probably coming up, two of our kids that grew up here. My daughter's going to be going to missions at Dallas Theological Seminary. We got another one that's probably going to be going to seminary right when he gets out of college. It's not mine. It's another one who grew up here too. So we would like to start a ministry fund for those folks too. So there's a lot of things that we want to do. But we're always hampered if people don't give. So the church can only do what we can do. So, anyway. All right, I commit to pray, and that's the final thing, and we are done. I commit to pray for St. Andrew's Church, its leaders, its ministry, and the work of the greater Anglican communion. We won't read those because we are done. But that is our final thing. So I commit to pray. This is a church of prayer, the prayer book. We pray every Sunday, but we ask you to commit to praying for us. It's a tough job. Our leaders, our bishops, everything at every level, we need prayer. So it's not just that you join here, by the way. We're going to ask you to volunteer if you want at the diocesan level. So we're just the first level. There's also a diocesan level, and then there's a national level. So you can commit to volunteer and to work up at variety of levels. And at each level, we need help. So we're just the base. And then as we move out to plant churches, which the diocese really wants more churches in this city, anyway, those are all the areas that you can help. So let's close in prayer, and if anyone has any questions, I will stay and answer those questions. So, Father God, I thank you so much for each and every person here, for each and every person online who's listening, and Father God, I would just ask that you would just bless everyone here as they consider the membership covenants, consider joining. And Lord, I just ask that you would bless them mightily in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, for all our visitors,